I admire your fortitude for lasting this long in the A&L training program. It's a pretty impressive set of stuff that you all are learning. And I wish that I had been able to take this course when I was a grad student. So I'm going to talk about big data analysis with Pairview. I work for Kitware. The agenda over this next hour, I'll start off with what the heck is Kitware. Then I'll talk about what is Pairview. And then I'll teach you the fundamentals of using Pairview in, especially with an eye towards high-performance computing contexts. What is Kitware? Kitware is a small company. We have an open-source services model. Almost all of our software is open-source, usually BSD licensed, so that it can be used in any kind of context without any licensing fees. And what we do, how we make our money, is that we sell our expertise in the areas that we are particularly knowledgeable about. So at Kitware, we know an awful lot about software process. We are the people behind CMake and C-Dash for continuous integration, that type of thing. Our software processors are pretty good. Our backbone is really in high-performance computing visualization. So VTK was our first project. And it's the blood of the company. We also do medical computing, medical visualization. More recently, we have expertise in computer vision. So if you're interested in obtaining knowledge from images or videos, we have people who know an awful lot about that as well. And we're also into big data and analytics in general. So with products like Tangelo and so forth. So how, if we give away almost all of our software, how do we make money? What we do is that we try to foster communities around the software which we put out there. So VTK today exists in some state. It has some set of capabilities and features. And you're free to use that in any kind of way that you want. And eventually you'll find stuff that you want it to do which it doesn't do or it doesn't do well. So you have the source code. You're free to go ahead and write and add these features to VTK yourself. Okay? And we definitely encourage you to do that, especially if you do that and then try to contribute them back to the main repository. Or you can come to Kitware and you can say, we need help implementing these new features. Can you do it for us? Could you help us do it? Can you advise us? And so we'll do that and you'll pay us some amount of money and this feature will get contributed into VTK automatically. So why would someone come to pay Kitware to do some development when the source is all open and they can do it themselves? It's basically because we have more stored knowledge in-house about how VTK and all our other open source projects work. So our development time is a lot lower than your development time as a newbie coming into this project. So if we can develop a feature within a week or a month and it takes you several months or a year, then your development time, whoever's paying you, is much more than you would have paid us to help you do it faster. So that's how we basically make our money. We try to foster these open source communities, and then we live off the frontier of what the software can do. Okay. I should say that we're not constantly just adding whatever new stuff goes in there. We put a lot of experimental code in there. The user base picks it up, starts using it, we get more and more people interested in it, and it continues to grow and thrive. Other stuff is just what done for a particular customer, it does exactly what that particular customer wanted, and it doesn't, and no one else picks it up. Eventually that will start, we will deprecate and then eventually remove that feature because once the maintenance cost of supporting this obscure feature start to grow. So our model at Kitware is building on the frontier of what the software can do and trying to really get people to contribute to the software and try to foster these communities where we all work together to make it better. Okay. Some of the things we're known for, VTK is the visualization toolkit. It is a software library which you can use to write applications to do. It's very good for scientific visualization, post-processing of data. And Pairview, which is a front end for VTK. We're also involved in ITK, as I said, CMake, Tangelo, a few other things, all of which we're trying to grow witness in this model. So what is ParaView? So as I said briefly, whereas VTK is a software library that you can use, you can write your applications and call into VTK to expose any of their ISO contouring or the volume rendering or the different readers and writers that we have available. To do that, you really have to be have a fairly high degree of proficiency in programming, specifically C++ programming. Okay? So instead, we realized a long time ago that a lot of scientists, really, they just want to open up the data and look at it and start playing with it. So we built ParaView on top of VTK to let people do this more easily without having to program the applications themselves. So ParaView started in about 1999 when Jim Ahrens from Los Alamos National Lab came to us and said, hey, you know, VTK is really great, but there aren't that many physical scientists who are also experts in C++ programming needed to make up their own applications, so let's make up an end-user application on top of it. Furthermore, he said, at Los Alamos, we're dealing with a lot of high-resolution data, so we want to enable, we want to make VTK scale using MPI for distributed memory parallel processing to make it scale for really large data sets. The first release came out in 2002. Between then and 2005, it grew from a variety of sources, different DOE and DOD labs, and various users around the world. And then in 2005, David Rogers and Brian Wiley, both then at Sandia National Lab, said, hey, VTK is great. We use it a lot for our production work. But you know, that Tickle TK interface is pretty dated looking. Secondary, it's great to visualize the data and produce these qualitative images of the data sets. But we really want to dive down a little deeper and be able to produce quantitative results. So we want to be able to expose the plots and charts and spreadsheets and things like that that you can dive down into the data for. And so they worked with us, and they partnered us with a company called CSimSoft, which are the QT experts behind the Qubit meshing tool. And we all worked together with some other partners. And in 2007, we released ParaView 3. ParaView 4 came out about a little more than a year ago. The thrust of this major release was to restructure the software behind the application. So very little changes were intended into the look and feel of the application, but the software behind it was split up into much finer grained modularity so that you could easily make products based off of the ParaView library and VTK, incidentally, which take only the parts, bits and pieces that you want without having to bring in the whole kitchen sink of all the generic processing that either of those libraries can do. We have a release schedule that varies between 3 and 6 months. We're going to have 4.2. We intend to have that come out, ParaView 4.2 and VTK 6.2. We intend to have both of those come out just before supercomputing this summer. Okay, so what should you expect from parallel ParaView? So we all know from Amdahl's law that the prospects for using parallelism to make any given fixed size problem scale faster and faster are pretty limited. Okay, so just by throwing that more and more CPUs at any given problem is unlikely to make it faster for a fixed size problem. But that being the case, if you take into account not just the CPUs, but also the memory of the machines, the nodes in the cluster, and the I/O capabilities, and you take into account that aspect, and you allow the data size to freely grow, then you really can get scalability out of it if you're including the data term, the size of the data. So although it's not true that you can run a given If you can run a given visualization on one node, if you run it on 8, it's going to be faster. It is true that if you can't run a visualization on one node, if you run it on 8 or 1,000 nodes, it will eventually be processable. Okay. So really, the parallelism in ParaView, the MPI parallelism, is really meant for scaling the data size, not for making anything faster. Okay. So it's been very successful. These results were showing that at Sandia, using the Black Rose Black Rose cluster, which has long since been decommissioned. They were processing data sets which were on the order of the low billions of cells, unstructured cells. I don't have a high watermark for what people have done with Paraview recently, but it's much higher than this because the processing hardware has evolved so much since then. So my personal record for large data visualization was that I was able to visualize a 10 billion unstructured cell problem, synthetic, on 4,096 Itanium-based nodes at the Intel Research Center, and render it at about 10 frames per second. So that's after significant startup times. Okay. That was through the Manta ray tracing engine. Okay. So it really does scale in many cases. Okay. So how does it all work? Okay. So generally, problems in visualization tend to be trivially parallelizable. Okay. So what we can do then is we can set up a VTK pipeline, starting with something like a reader and following into a contour operator, following into a slice filter, following into a various other algorithms. And we'll set up identical visualization pipelines on the many nodes of the HPC resource that you have at hand. Those will all feed into each other. Ideally, there is little or no communication between these. We use ghost cells to make that happen a lot more than you would expect it to happen. And then eventually, we'll render in parallel depth composite and produce an image, a globally correct image. So those in the Paraview architecture, we break up the different parts of that visualization pipeline into three abstract components. So we have a data server component, a render server component, and a client component. These can be mixed and matched in various ways. The client component is not a MPI parallel job in most cases, but the data server and the render server components are. So we have one or more nodes in the data server component, and their job in the data server is to read in the data from disk, or obtain it somehow, apply the data manipulation operations, and produce renderable geometry. Then the data server delivers the renderable geometry to the render server, and the render server's job is to render these into screen images. And then the client connects to this and controls the session and usually displays the image. If the data is small enough, the renderable geometry is small enough, it can be delivered directly to the client, and the client can take over the rendering locally. So we can combine these three different abstract components in various different ways. When you start up Paraview, you're running in what's called the built-in or standalone or serial mode on your laptop, where you have the data server, render server, and client all living within a single process, just talking to each other via direct pointer access. The next most important mode is called the combined server mode, where you have the data server and render server components, each of which exists together in the processes within an MPI job. And those are connected to a client which controls them and sometimes displays their images. More importantly is the batch mode, where you take the client out of the situation, and we just have the combined render server and data server components within an MPI job, and these just run whatever script you tell them to run and produce results on the server without your interaction other than telling it to run. Okay. There is also a mode called the split server mode, which in which the data server and the render server run on different parallel machines, and it turns out that this is almost never efficient. So the idea here is that you could run the data server component on Mira, the simulation resource here at Argonne, and then run the visualization on Tukey, the visualization resource with the graphics cards, and then control that from the client. And it is almost always the case that the cost of delivering the geometry from Mira to Tukey for rendering is not recoupable in the faster rendering capabilities of the GPUs. So we almost always, on really big data, we almost always build in OS Mesa and just do pure software rendering on the simulation side. So that given that said, how do you know if your pair view is capable of running on big data? So first I'll say an apology that the pair view binaries that you can download from Kitware are, although some of them have MPI turned on and enabled in them, it's almost never what you want to use for doing large data processing. So we wrap up some version of MPI, and depending on the operating system and the version and stuff like that, and we sometimes deliver it with our binaries. But that MPI is almost never compatible with the MPI that you have installed on your cluster. And even if it is compatible, it's almost never efficient on your resource. So that said, you definitely need MPI turned on. We also highly recommend Python. Each iteration of PairView, we're getting more and more tightly bound into Python. It's still the case where you can build PairView and use it without Python, but you're missing an awful lot of stuff. For instance, you're missing the batch processing capabilities. So you'll be without Python turned on, you'll be limited to interactive visualization through the GUI, which is not reproducible and so forth. So ways to get parallel PairView are, one, access a system where it's already installed. On the PairView wiki, under wiki PairView HPC installations, I've been trying to maintain a list of all the open parallel centers that have PairView installed or that I've been able to install PairView on, with links to either the sites or our own instructions for how to use it. So that's the first place to look. If you're using Linux or some versions of Mac, check with your packager. For instance, Fedora has MPI turned on in their PairView, so it's conceivable that if you have a Fedora cluster or a Red Hat cluster, you can download PairView MPI version and run it scalably. And if not, then you have to build PairView from source yourself. Okay? Two configuration options I've said before are that to turn on Python and turn on MPI. It's also important usually to turn off Qt. Okay? Building in the Qt components that are required for the client adds a lot of time to the build process and makes it more likely that your favorite compiler on your HPC resource is not going to be able to build PairView because it can't build Qt or Qt's components. So if you're building parallel PairView, turn on Python, turn on MPI, and turn off Qt. We have instructions for how to do this on the PairView wiki, and we have what's called the super build, which is source code for how we make our releases. It's also how I make the installations for the machines that I have access to, like Argonne and Oak Ridge, which will do this for you. Those are a good place to start from. Okay. So about Python on HPC resources. Really, is it a good idea to run an interpreted language on an HPC system? Turns out it's not that bad. Okay, Python itself first, you definitely need Python in your PairView build, as I said, because you don't get batch processing with PairView, which you really want on any large size process. You're not going to generally use the GUI when you're connected to thousands of nodes because your job reservation is going to take a week or something like that to get through the queue. So turn on Python, and then the next problem is that Python generally operates with shared libraries. Okay. In the past, it was true that the operating systems on the various HPC machines, Krays and BlueJeans, didn't support shared libraries. That's less true today than it was before. So you should compile Python itself in statically, and furthermore, you want to make sure that the Python, not just Python itself, but all of the standard extension modules, the C extension modules, like Math, NumPy, things like that, which actually in the Python they call out to compiled C code, that they're also compiled statically and brought in at runtime during initialization without opening up a file. So it's best to compile statically. And so what we've done at Kitware, we CMakeified Python's build system. Recently, we've done the same thing for NumPy, so that we can build it statically fairly easily, including all of these extension modules into the initialization time. Again, if you go to the PairView Super Build project, you can see how we do that for Cray and BlueJean systems. So that said, we need Python. How do you learn ParaView's Python interface? Okay. The easiest and best way to go about doing it is to record your actions in the GUI in a trace file. Okay. To do that, start up the ParaView GUI, go to the Tools menu, go to Start Trace, do anything you want in the GUI, and when you're done, say Tools Stop Trace. That will pop up a Python script saying everything that you just did in Python's and ParaView's Python syntax. Then you can play that Python's trace back through PVBatch or PVPython, or if you have your libraries and modules correctly loaded into your favorite Python interpreter, you can do the same thing from IDLE or whatever other Python project you want. So once you save the trace, assuming you have your libraries and your Python path set up, you can fully call into ParaView from any other Python-enabled application you'd like. Okay. The next resource I recommend for learning ParaView's Python interface is within ParaView, the GUI. If you go to the Tools menu and you start the Python shell, this gives you a Python interpreter with all the state loaded as I've just described. Which you can type things into and see them happen in the GUI. So this gives you really nice things like tab completion, better help system. And more importantly, besides tab completion, the other thing I really like about this is that you can see things happen immediately in the GUI from while you type them in the shell. So it's a really good place to learn about how to do things in ParaView's Python interface. Lastly, if you go to the ParaView guide or equivalently the wiki, there's a chapter there which gives you all the nitty-gritty details about how to do various things in ParaView through Python. Okay. So are there any questions? I'm getting a lot of puzzled looks right now. Okay, you guys are all more or less with me? Okay, good. So we'll go on. Okay, so now the first exercise. Does anyone here have ParaView loaded on their machines? Couple of you. Most of you. Excellent. Cool. Okay. So I want you to go ahead and do exactly what I said. Let's record a Python interaction in ParaView. Okay. So start up ParaView. Now, first thing, go to the Tools menu, and at the bottom, hit Start Trace. Okay. Now, go to the Sources menu and choose the Wavelet. Now, just like Cyrus said, just like in Visit, these tools are meant for large data processing, wherein any given action you take could take a long time in the HPC context. Generally, you don't see anything happen until you hit Apply. Okay, so you go to Sources Wavelet and then hit Apply. Choose the default options. Okay, so what this does is you've just created a procedurally generated synthetic source. It's a structured grid with some made-up data on the points, I think, in this case. You can do either. Next thing, we'll do we'll apply an algorithm to create some derived data. So go to the Filters menu, and under the alphabetical list, which shows you the entire list of filters that ParaView has, there's different subsets and shortcuts and things like that, find the slice filter, and then hit the Z normal button to orient the slice so it's facing us, okay. And then hit Apply. Okay, so I forget who asked the question earlier, but there's different options on the filters. The slice, the default option is a slicing plane, but you can choose a sphere and a square and things, a couple of other things there too. Okay. Now you should see a square colored in with some synthetic data in there. Okay. Okay. Now go to the Filters menu again, and insert an ISO contour filter. And again, hit Apply. Now you should see something that looks a little bit like this hard to see image up here in the corner. Mm-hmm. Yes? All the filters are disabled. Click on the wavelet to the left on the pipeline browser. So click there and you make that particular data product active, and then you can apply filters to that data product. Okay. And once you've applied the contour filter, you should have something that looks like this shape up here. Then go to the Tools menu and hit Stop Trace. How many are looking at a Python script? Okay, a lot of you. Okay. So now that you have Python trace, I'll demonstrate quickly. So I went to sources and created a synthetic data set. Hit apply, and I see something. Okay. I want to learn more about this, so I'm going to insert a slice. And I don't like that orientation, so I'll change it so it's looking directly at me. Just do a little off-center and hit apply and hit the ISO contour and apply. Okay. And of course, I forgot to record what I was doing here. So go to tools and start trace. I should have done that in the beginning, and stop trace, and you'll get a Python script. How about this? I'll just change this guy's parameters, properties and of the ISO of the slice, change his orientation a bit. Apply, and I go to tools, stop trace, and then I've got a Python script. Yours will be longer because you started at the beginning and I didn't do that. But that Python script is all you need to do to replay this visualization somewhere else. Okay. So that's the best way to start learning ParaView is through the trace. Okay. The next thing I'd like you to do is to start up PVBatch, which is one of the Python interfaces to ParaView. So I'm going to run applications, ParaView. How you start it varies based on different things. Bin, I'll run PVBatch, and I'm going to give it, I'm going to give it something. Let me start this up again. I'll do a tools, start trace, make a data set, apply, tools, stop trace, file, save, and I'll save it on my desktop as example.py. Okay, and then I'll quit out of here. And then I'll run PVBatch applications bin. If I run PVBatch and I give it the path to that file I just saved, it will go and run something. So it quickly came up and drew a sphere and went away. Okay, so we definitely don't want to do that. We want to save off an image. So let's edit that recorded script. And at the very end of it, put a write image example.png. Run that. Okay, and then if I look at example.png, now I have the saved off. Saved off visualization result. Okay, so the entire steps were to start ParaView GUI, turn on tools start trace, do something, say tools stop trace, save that off as a Python file, and then run PVBatch, give it that Python file, and it will do the same thing. Okay, so that's the entry into how to learn about ParaView's Python scripting. Okay, so you can imagine how you can make this more and more complicated the more you know about ParaView's Python scripting interface. So the next question, it's a lot less of a question, but is it a good idea to do rendering on a Cray or some of the really high-end machines? And it turns out that that's even less of a problem. The current generation of leadership class machines are all getting GPUs and similar things in them, so the situation is changing. But in the past, what we've always done is say, build OS Mesa. So Mesa is a software implementation of OpenGL. And make sure that you build that statically and so forth. And then configure ParaView to use OS Mesa as its OpenGL library. Okay. And if you do it right, and there are descriptions on the wiki page about how to set it up properly for various versions of Pairview and Mesa, then you're doing all the rendering in software on the CPUs. And like I said, rendering in software isn't as bad as you'd think it would be. The cost of rendering triangles from a CPU is almost always it's almost always faster than it would be to ship those same triangles over somewhere else with a graphics card. Okay. And again, the Pairview Superbuild project does this, sets that all up for you for various Cray's and BlueG systems. And in the end, what happens is that we do depth compositing. So we have a parallel rendering render server. Each of the nodes in the server is going to have its own section of the data. So I said we run identical copies of the VTK pipeline, each of which is given a different section of the data. For instance, if you run a simulation, you'll typically have 100 I/O nodes, all of which are writing out their own portions of their own files of the simulation run. You just load those same files up in parallel into Pairview, and then process them locally. And at the end of the render server, you get images out of each one of these. Okay. When we save out the images, we save them out. We obtain them with color and depth information for every pixel, so that we know the color and the depth of everything rendered on each node in parallel. And then we combine all of the images together to get the globally correct information, globally correct picture. Since the advent of binary swap, this depth compositing isn't as expensive as you'd think it would be. It turns out it's a logarithmic process, so it's only incrementally slower to do depth compositing on 1,000 nodes than it is to do it on 100 nodes. Okay, so it's really not that expensive. And we and Visit use the ICE-T library, which does it particularly efficiently. It lowers the constant time and so forth as well. Okay. So all about visualizing on Big Iron. It turns out to be once you have Pairview installed somewhere on a big machine, it's all about wrangling your paths. Okay. We do Pairview. We build Pairview binaries, and we have Python modules available. So you have to have in your path, you have to have the paths to the Pairview binaries and all the Python modules that you're going to load. Okay. Typically, once it's installed by the competent sysadmins, not by myself, there is a module somewhere which you can just load or soft add to get Pairview access to Pairview. If not, if you build it yourself, then you might want to do it by hand, set up the paths yourself. But once you get that set up, it's not too hard to get access to Pairview. So once you have Pairview, then how do you run it on these machines? Then you have to interact with the batch scheduler, just like any other thing you're going to do on HPC system. Okay. So for an unattended batch session, you'll say qsub to reserve some nodes, and you'll set up your environment, and you'll reserve some number of nodes, give it a particular queue and a particular project to charge against, and you'll give it the path. You'll tell it to MPI run or AP run on the Cray's. You'll give it the path to MPI run the Pairview batch application, for instance. And just like you did here when we ran PV batched on that Python file, we do the exact same thing in parallel. Okay. For exploratory visualization, when you're just looking at the data for the first time, it's useful to do interactive visualization. So the only big difference here is that you generally use qsub-i to reserve some nodes for interactive use. You'll typically reserve a smaller set of nodes for some limited amount of time, and then once you've got those nodes back, you're logged into a service node or something like that. Then interactively, you'll run MPI run Pairview batch some file, and then you'll SCP the results back to your local machine and iterate. Okay, if you're connected through remote desktop or something like that, you can look at the files directly. Okay, so we can try this if we have enough time. Let's see. So what I'd say is to SSH to Tukey, if you all have your keys here. My key is almost out of battery, so oftentimes I can't tell the difference between an 8 and a 0. on these things because the lines are going out. So it may not work for me. But what we'll do is we'll SSH to the machine, reserve some nodes interactively, just a couple of them for like two nodes for 5 minutes, something like that should be sufficient. Okay. Then we'll soft add pair view, and then we'll run MPI exec, tell it to run this script that we just recorded. Okay. So first I'm going to SSH into the machine, and I'm going to SSH in with port forwarding. So I'm making up a number here, and I'm saying that I'm going to log in to my account on Tucky. And I'm going to log in such that on the remote side, port number 50787, which I just made up, is connected to my local machine's port 22, which is SSH. Okay. Try that. Now I'll type in my secure ID key, hopefully. Okay. And then I will, actually what I'm going to do is I'm just going to run this demo. So what I'm doing is I'm going to reserve some nodes. I'm going to reserve two nodes for 5 minutes under the project, which I'm allowed to charge. And I'm going to run this batch script. So let's try this. Qsub dash I for, I'm sorry. Thank you. Heard it that time. Hopefully, a few minutes, that'll come back. Now I'll be logged on to one of the service nodes or something like that. It varies on system to system. So hopefully this will come back. Okay, so I've got an interactive session. Now what I can do is soft add plus pairview dash 4.1.0. Okay, which PV batch? Okay, so I've got a PV batch here, and I'll say MPI exec dash N2 dash machine file cobalt node file. Pairview batch. And I'll give it the the location of a Python script I've already created, and hopefully that'll run. Okay. And if I look here, now I have a parallel sphere, an image created. So I reserve some node qsub dash I, and then once I did that, I did soft env add pair view. And then I ran MPI exec on my interactively reserved nodes, and I told them to run this Python script. And in that Python script, the Python script I've run looks like this. Okay. So in the end, so I do some visualization, and in the end, I call write image to create some image. Okay. To get that back, I can pipe that back over the SSH tunnel I created originally. And of course, I've lost the TCP tunnel here because I've reserved into something else. So what I will do is okay, now it's asking me for the password of my local machine. And once I do that, I have this PNG file here, which looks similar to the other one that we've created, but this was created in parallel on the server. Okay, so I opened up a tunnel when I SSH'd into the machine, and then I ran a parallel job, and it told it to run some Python script, which I'd recorded in the ParaView GUI. At the end, I put a write image at it, and then I SCP'd that result back to my local machine for looking at the data. Okay. So for really large data, you generally always want to run it in batch mode, because the interactive time to the wait time in the queue to get more than 100 nodes is usually going to take a long time for really big data. So for really big data, you want to run exactly what we did right there, PV batch mode. Yes, go ahead.
The script that you ran, you could have recorded that on your laptop or whatever, and then, but when you called it there, it automatically ran it in batch mode over those. Mm-hmm. You didn't have to be like, oh, I'm going to write it so that it's automatically, you didn't have to do anything. You just told it to do it.
Yeah, exactly. And the only difference is that in my case, I was procedurally generating some data for simplicity. But in practice, I'm going to make sure the paths to all the files you open are correct for the system that you're running on. So if I recorded a script where I was recording it on my laptop, then the path might be in tilde desktop. And then when I'm running it on Mira or Toki, I don't have a tilde desktop. So that's the only major change you have to do. Batch mode is good for big data visualization. For moderate-sized data visualization, it's useful to do interactive processing. What you want to do is, in the ParaView GUI, go to File Connect, and that will open up a set of dialogs where you fill in the connection information. So in my local machine, I'd SSH'd into something and opened up a port, and then I ran a QSUB script to reserve some node and ran MPI. Generally, you set that up once in the ParaView GUI, and then you just use that over and over again. Okay. So some of the details. It gets pretty hairy. Every different HPC system has different layout, different syntax for starting QSUB and so forth. And ideally, in simplest case, the desktop and the compute nodes are all on the same cluster, and there's no firewall in between them. More often, it's the case where you log into you connect to a login node, and then you submit a job, which gives you access to the compute nodes, and it can get even more complicated. Okay. On the ParaView Wiki, there's descriptions for all of these. When you go File Connect within the GUI and click Add Server, this is where you type in the IP address of the machine you're trying to connect to, tukey@alcf.anl.gov, for instance. Some of the things you'll see there are server type, whether this is a client server mode or is this a split server mode, client render server mode, render server data server mode, things like that. Startup type, what that means is whether or not you want to be responsible for starting up the server or the compute on the compute nodes yourself, or if you want the script to take care of it itself. Command is where you type in some commands that you use to access and log in, reserve some nodes. Some of the caveats here is that it doesn't matter if you're running on Mac and connecting to a Windows HPC machine, or if you're running on Linux or running on Windows and connecting to an HPC machine. The only things that really matter are that the release number of ParaView on both sides have to match. Release number of client has to match the other side and so forth, because the syntax we use for our remote procedure call and stuff like that varies. Okay. Another difference is on Windows, they're slightly different syntax. I've set them up on Oak Ridge, I haven't done it here. The way you spawn SSH varies on different machines. There is no X term generally on Windows, things like that. Okay, go ahead.
For the batch processing, basically you have to create the script, right?
Yep.
The Python script.
Yes.
Many times, let's assume we get data, we don't really know what we should look for.
Yes.
Until we actually visualize the data.
Yes.
So how should we get out of this circle, right? I mean, how can I create a Python script that is proper when I don't even know what I should look for? Can I get a low quality image or something?
Okay. Yeah, so the question was, for real problems, you don't really, it's not really feasible to just make a batch script, which is going to work in all cases, because you don't know what you're looking for. You don't know the extent of the data, so you don't know where the camera should be and so forth. What I recommend is, what most people do is they use interactive visualization for a small but representative problem, and then they play that back on the larger problem sizes. Okay. So if you can, reduce the size of the data and then interact with it. There's also filters you can apply interactively, which will subsample and things like that. To make it more interactive. Yes.
Okay, so you can take a snapshot at low resolution, and then you can do a batch processing at high resolution.
Yes. Yeah, exactly, and things like that. So it boils down to data reduction first, some ways, at somewhere. And when you're good enough at the Pairview scripting language, if you read enough about it, you can figure out you can query the data in the script and adjust the script parameters based on that. But that takes a while. To figure out and explain how to do that. Okay. Tunneling, I've demonstrated it with SSH-P. This comes into play whenever there are firewalls involved. The idea is you connect over SSH to the machine, and at the same time you tell SSH to open up a reserved port between you and the remote machine. Okay. Fortunately, the details of all of that vary and they get quite hairy. Fortunately, you can save off these connection parameters once they're set up, and then you can share those with each other. Okay? So only one person has to go through the pain of figuring out on this particular version of the cluster what the proper magic syntax is for doing all this. Once it's set up in Pairview and say connect, it's saved in your preferences, specifically in what's called a PVSC, Pairview Server Configuration file, which on Windows, they're saved off here. And Linux and Mac, they're saved off in tilde.config. The syntax is explained on the wiki. And in general, within the Pairview GUI, after you hit the connect, there is an option to fetch servers. So I or someone at any of the support people at the labs can figure out these scripts for you, post them somewhere on the web or locally on their machine. And then in the GUI, you can say fetch the server connection. Okay, so the next exercise is to try to obtain a PVSC for Tukey. Okay, and I apologize if you're on Windows. I haven't built the Windows connection script. I'll try to post that later. But otherwise, start up Pairview, go to File Connect, and hit the Fetch Servers button. And then say Edit Sources. And then you have to add this. It says PVSC. www.pairview.org, wiki, images, blah, 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 blah. Again, on the Pairview wiki, I've tried to maintain a list of all the HPC systems, and they have information about each one of these, where you can find that. But if you do this, you can find the configuration for Tukey and import it. So I'll demonstrate here. Start Pairview. And sorry, you can't see my menu, but I don't want to change my resolution again. And go to File Connect. And then I will say Fetch Servers and Edit Sources. And I've already got it loaded here. So that's PVSC HTTP www.pairview.org. Wiki, images, 99, argon, XML, blah, blah. Okay. And then I will click on this configuration and say import. Whoever administered that XML might have a bunch of machines you don't care about. Until a few hours ago, there was a Eureka, which I think is decommissioned now. But then once it's loaded, then you just say connect and this will give you a dialog with the specifics of how to connect to this machine. Okay, so it's saying SSH, that's really not too important. Tukey, we'll keep that. Username, you probably want to change it from Demarl to your own username. Okay. The client and server port are kind of randomly generated, so those are okay. Pick some small number of nodes to reserve, some small number of minutes. Fill in your own account. Charge against. Default queue is fine. Usually you want like default or debug, something like that. The specifics vary, but it's the same queue that you're going to want for interactive debugging, usually, okay, for small visualization. Until you get things set up, then you can change that. Okay. And then when you hit OK, it popped up over here with an xterm for me. If it didn't pop up with an xterm, it probably means that you don't have xQuartz, which is most recent versions of Macintosh no longer include X11. So now you have to download something called xQuartz. Before in Lion and I think Snow Leopard, and before it was X11 was included in Mac OS. Now it's not. So you download Xcode. And this will pop up with an xterm, which is SSH'd into the machine with all the port forwarding stuff I just talked about. And then I will type in my passkey here. Aha, in that case, I got the right key. I could read it by chance. No, it did not let me in that time either. Sorry. So I can't demonstrate this because my battery on this is gone. Once you are connected, it'll pop up with a simple menu. And generally what I do there is type S over and over again because it gives you a view of the queue, and I wait till my jobs are in the running state. Once they're in the running state, you'll know because because it will operate something like this. I'm just going to run a local session here to demonstrate. Run the PV server job. This is going to give me trouble too. You'll know because once it establishes the connection, the view area will become filled again with the black screen. And the other thing you'll notice is that on the pipeline browser, it will no longer say built-in. It will say the server name, usually something like localhost something, something. Okay. And then within, if you go to the file option, you'll be browsing the remote file system. Okay. So that's about all I have time for on the slides. There's some more details about some configuration settings you should tweak when you're operating on remote data, and so forth, and some more details about how to use PairView itself. I've tried to focus on how to use PairView on this system here in HPC context, and I've skipped over all the details about how to use PairView itself, and so forth, and some of the research we're doing now. But if you go to pairview.org, you can find through there, you can find the user's guide, the tutorial, which we typically teach and update every supercomputing, and webinars, and the mailing list. Okay. Well, thanks.